everyone, and welcome back to yet another episode of Cinematters, the podcast on cinema from the northeast of India, where we tell you why you should be watching these films if you're not doing so already. I am your host, Arshia Dhaur, and today we finally have a film that is not from Assam. It is, in fact, from Manipur, a 2011 film by the name Fiji Gimoni, directed by Oynom Gautam Singh. It is available for watching on YouTube, and it's a story of a family where the son, who is an aspiring boxer, later gets estranged from his family. He goes on to get married, he has a child, and all the while, his aging parents, especially his mother, longs for him. She is seen pining away for him. His sister acts as the catalyst, bringing the family back together eventually.
Tamo, mother, the phone talker.
Togri, Togi Kalamani, Tabaru Kralak the Gi, Maduana, Togum Kit.
Kitang Tuna Togu the Jumani. I get over Zanuna, Nushatiramani. Tamona Wang Kakang Hirakuni, Imana Kaurang Aido. Tamona Suhina Kangli Buduni. Imana Tamu get the Makam Wajaiba. Machaki the Makayai Panaba Kaliba, Mamma Pagim upon the Tamona Wahim Kakang Hiba, the Atukam Chingarati. Wado, hai dayo. Hujik ti tamuna lo sinduna thambai ma thoktadri.
Now, it's a 1 hour, 50-minute long film starring Gurumayum Bonny as Sana Jaoba, the son. Laishingtham Tonthuingami Devi as Yaiphebi, who is the sister. Abhinav Ilangam, Y. Kumarjeet, Shamdhoni, Shanti, Sarojini are among the other members of the cast. Today, we again have with us the wonderful Shivanti Chatterjee, sound anthropologist and teacher of sociology, to talk to us about this very interesting film. Welcome back again, Shivanti. It's absolutely wonderful to have you with us, of course. Now, Fiji Gimoni won the National Film Award for the Best Feature Film in Manipuri, and Laishingtham won the National Award for the Best Supporting Actress in the same year. This film largely received positive reviews. If you go and check online, you'll see that. For being made and highlighting issues of migration out of Manipur and other parts of the Northeast. It is a phenomenon we are all largely familiar with. And, you know, if you come from places that are not among the larger employing cities, like, you know, a Delhi or a Bombay or a Bangalore. And, you know, I'm saying this with respect to when this film was made, which was almost exactly a decade back. And by then, it had already become quite well established that this is where most of India's urban youth would eventually head and find themselves in the hope for better opportunities, as avenues had already begun to dry up back at home. Now, Shivanti, let's begin with the broader themes that the film deals with, which is of family dynamics and the various positions of privilege enjoyed by the male child, as we can see in the film, as opposed to what is granted to the daughters in the society that is depicted in the film.
Yes, thank you, Ashya. So it's good to be back again.
It is.
And yeah, so like you mentioned that, you know, how the male child privilege, or also how the son and daughter, moments are represented in the film, that is very strongly highlighted, because Yaiphebi, who is... we are actually listening to the story or experiencing the story through Yaiphebi's eyes, okay? And it is either through her diary reading that that she's giving us a window into her brother's days at the sports academy where he was training,
yeah,
and where he had met his then girlfriend Bicha,
yeah,
or about even how their entire family is actually living to support his brother's dream of becoming a boxer.
Yeah.
And again, like you mentioned, the patriarchal structure or the privileges, in the sense we see that the mother is very giving and loving and has a very silent presence throughout the film, where she is very selflessly devoted to wishing for the well-being of her son.
Yeah.
And she has literally not much of an expectation, but only the well-being of her son. Whereas the father also expects the mother to just, you know, show a very happy face to the son so that he doesn't get distressed. And the uncle and the father of the family are, you know, dealing with the financial situation and seeing whether the sports education continues or whether, you know, this National Academy participation and all of that, participation in the national sports get to happen. You also see that the boys are very used to not just, not just the protagonist here, that is not just Sanajawa, but also his brother. You see that they have a sort of taken for granted attitude from their family.
Yeah.
Because we also see towards the end where, Sanajawa's Ina, or for his aunt, you know, is requesting her only daughter to come and visit his father. But he is so busy and immersed in his work that he misses his father's last rites. It is, which is quite telling, because it just says that somehow, if there is a daughter to take care at home, if there is a mother figure, then the sons do not feel compelled to be part of these daily domestic and, events of life, which could be grief, which could be happiness. And also, throughout the film, we also realize that there is some sort of miscommunication whereby we do not really get to understand when Sanajawa gets married. And it is also an inter-community marriage, okay, which is quite a highlight. Also, that brings about different things. We do not really understand whether it is the inter-community marriage that has got the mother and son miffed with each other, or is it just the lack of communication that has faded across the years, which is not really explained, I feel, which is a good thing also, because, it brings out different flares. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, we also see that there is initially, we see this at a later stage in the story, of course, but we believe it's at an earlier part of the timeline that is covered in the film, where we see how the mother and the family gets to hear a lot of rumors about her son being spotted with a child, and she's absolutely unwilling to believe people. And she feels that people are just doing this to disrupt their lives and to, they're perhaps jealous of her son. Even though it's absolutely clear that, you know, she was not included as a part of his new life that he had set up with his wife, and he already has a daughter, and they were not in touch perhaps for the longest time. So we do see some of these themes play out of its estrangement, of abandonment. You correctly point to that. Now we can also see, like you just mentioned, that the Manipuri society, if I'm not mistaken, this is a Methi family that we see in this film. There is a sort of obsession with the male child in general. I mean, going simply beyond the patriarchal structures, which grants more freedom, more agency, and definitely a lot of privileges, far more than the woman has been granted in the patriarchal structure. The male children are, of course, granted far more of that. we see that there is this obsession that the mother, that is Sanajaba's mother, has with him, which, like you said, is selfless love, of course, and she expects very little back from him. You know, we see how, you know, in the flashback where when Sanajaba is out for one of his boxing matches, which he eventually does not end up winning, but we can see how his mother sets aside food for him, even though he's not at home, you know, he's absent from home. And when Yai Phabi asks her mother why she does this, her explanation is, I just feel like if I do this, my son is going to be safe. He, wherever he is, I feel like he's well taken care of. So that in itself, that scene was extremely telling, I thought, as to just how blind this whole, I would choose to call it obsession for sure, even if someone else does not, but I would definitely choose to call this a very distinct obsession with the male child, especially when it comes to the Indian, when it comes to the context of Indian families. So, yeah. And despite the fact that eventually Sanajaba leaves his home, he does not keep in touch with his aging and ailing parents, the moment the sister puts them back in touch, everything seems to have been forgiven. If not forgotten, definitely everything seems to have been forgiven. So in that sense, we see that how, despite the fact that it is the daughter who is the one putting in all the effort to reunite the family, she travels all the way to a different city to meet her brother, who has, you know, set up a completely new life without them. He has given up on his sporting dreams to lead a very cushy life with what seems like a white collar job. You know, he has his own big home. He has his wife. He has his daughter. She is never really given her due credit explicitly, you know, Yai Phabi's character, or for that matter, any other female character in the film. And in fact, the meaning of the title of the film, that is Pijigi Muni, is actually my only gem. And while one would imagine that this, of course, alludes to the male child or the son, which is Sanajaba in this film, I wish it was talking about the woman, you know, it was talking about the sister Yai Phabi. I mean, I don't know. I guess that's not what it was meant for, but you can, of course, read the film in its various different layers. You can take away your own interpretations. And also, I believe this because the film, like you mentioned right at the beginning, is seen through the point of view of Yai Phabi. Another very interesting female character whom you cursorily touched upon was the love interest of Sanajaba, which is Bicha, and they meet in the sports training academy where she was a budding archer, and she really came across as this very ambitious and feisty figure, at least in the first half of her life. And what struck me as quite revealing is how each female character's arc in this film eventually leads them to become a mellower version of themselves as a result of their circumstances, you know, eventually. When we first meet Yai Phabi, you know, we see her as this young, sincere, very hardworking girl who wants to become a scientist. And she also takes on these, you know, Eve teasers or bullies on the road. And she comes across as quite a strong figure when she does that. But by the time we meet her again, we realize she has already completed her PhD. You know, we meet her again in the present day track when she's traveling to her brother's home in the hope that she's going to be able to reunite him with her family. So, and on this journey also, she again stumbles upon Bicha, and we come to know that she again has given up on her archery and now she works for NGO. So, you know, we can see how their personalities have perhaps been watered down a little. Would you agree with me over there?
Yeah, in a way that is true, because it just shows how also not just Bicha and Yai Phabi, Also, I would say Jessica, who is Sana Jawa's wife, we get to meet in the second half of the film. We see that somehow their struggles are not discussed in details. They are cursorily, you know, marked out to, you know, give some depth to the story, yes, but we do not really know how they have come this far. So we do, like you mentioned, like Vicha is winning silver medals as an archer for the national team. And she probably is unable to give adequate time for the romance because she was focusing on her career. So also left very murky, but that is how their romance also starts hitting, because Sana Jawa is unable to figure out how she's not having enough time for them. That is a different story, that she does not have a sporting career really, and she becomes a champion of gender or women empowerment in an NGO as a program officer in the current times. So she's also quite upset with how her sporting dreams came crashing down. Yai Phabi, on the other hand, she gets pleasantly surprised when she realizes that Vicha has come to know that she's become a doctorate now, and congratulates her, because it just seems that she has accepted it as just another event in her life. Like you're saying, that it is watered down, and now her focus is on marriage, which is a social expectation. And she's also because that event is so meaningful for her family, she's also come to include and involve her brother, who has become estranged, you know, along these years, and takes this step and meet him in this new world. So and also through the little references from Jessica's narrative, we don't really know, in fact, Lang Lin is their child, or whether Lang Lin lived with Jessica from before, you know, because it just shows that they developed a friendship which just happened. It wasn't a cultivated romance.
It was circumstantial.
So, which is very interesting. Yeah, it was circumstantial. So, which is also very interesting, but we somehow do not know what Jessica had a rented house. So she was probably a landlady. We don't know whether she and her mother does this, or her generation does this, or something like that. But we're not given insight into that world. It is just mentioned as an anecdote.
Right.
To just, you know, add to the story, I see. So these things, yes. Also, I feel, you know, the fact that they are showing a Khasi Meitei union. And the ending of the traditional bow, where there is a Mundan ceremony, which is a very Hindu ceremony, I would say, which is Lakokpa, if I'm not mistaken, in Meitei community.
Yeah.
So, so that also says that whereas a Khasi society is, you know, matrilineal, you suddenly see with this Meitei Khasi union, it's that part of the narrative is not really shown, or deliberately not touched upon. I feel that is where I had a slight question or curiosity as to how it was, and which also shows that maybe to belong, to find a place in the community, then you need to be within the Manipuri set up in a particular way. So that kind of a thing,
You do touch upon some very sort of aspects of the film which I think can easily go unnoticed. So thank you for that. Now, like I was mentioning, that you know, when you look at the female characters, because I really felt like the film belonged to the women, even though the films, I really don't know if this was a very conscious or unconscious sort of trick, if I may use that word, used to, in a way, subvert their narratives. But I really felt like a lot of subversion was happening, that the women were taking hold of the narrative in the film, even though the story is centered on the men, you know, and how the men constantly keep evading their responsibilities, and how much their lives, in a way also, how much the lives of the men are also weighed down by the expectations of the societies they live in. So, but, you know, at the end of the day, because this film, like the other films that we've discussed on this podcast, also has its premise based in the unit of the family, and understandably so, we can see that the women at the end of the day are getting really weighed down by their domestic responsibilities. You know, we see in a particular scene that Yai Phabi says she has no space or room to think about anything beyond what her parents have to keep saying about her brother. So she can't even spare a thought about settling down in her own life or getting married. It's only after she manages to reconnect with her brother that she finally can think about getting married, can actually have her parents also think about it. So you can see the way this, you know, this tug of war, this constant tussle for power and control that's happening within these family units between the various genders. And I feel like that's also something that the film does really well. And there is this constant deliberation of collective identities, as seen in the indigenous cultures and societies of the Northeast, that we have constantly noticed in the films that we have so far discussed on the podcast. And Pijigi Muni is absolutely no, you know, exception to that rule. Before I proceed, I would also like to mention to our audience that, unlike our previous episodes, this time round, we were unfortunately unable to reach any of the cast or crew members of the film. You know, our messages and emails went unanswered till the time of recording this episode. Now, Shebonti, I wanted to sort of touch upon the sound or the music that has been used in the film. I felt that this film uses sound and music rather differently from how we have seen the other films that we have spoken about on this podcast, how they have used it. There are times in the film when I felt that the background score was quite overpowering to the point of being a little jarring. Again, you know, it's anybody's guess as to whether this was done intentionally, whether this was done to evoke a certain kind of reaction from the audience or from the characters, you know, to supplement or to complement what was going on screen. You know, what were your thoughts on this particular aspect of the film?
There has been a constant use of instrumentals throughout the narrative, and the film is shot in a very documentary style, which gives it a different kind of feel also, you know, scene by scene. And I didn't particularly find the music jarring, but I felt that it was constant, if not, you know, it was constant in throughout, that was there. Regarding the use of instruments, I felt that because, you know, most of the instruments that were used were Western, like piano, strings, or keyboard. And the other instrument which can be used in both Western and Eastern context was flute. And that, I felt, flute was mostly used when there was these domestic scenes that was being played out at Sana Jawba's home, where the father and mother are discussing the future of their son, or when the sister is having a serious conversation regarding how he should try and mend his relation with Emma, that is his mother. Also, I felt that the movie deliberately probably uses two songs and two full-fledged songs. One in the beginning, which is sort of visualizing the romance between Sana Jawba and Richa. And the last one towards the end, where there is this ceremony which is happening, you know, the Mundan ceremony, where you find that Langlen, the daughter, is being accepted as a member of the Meitei community.
Yeah.
Which were the only two places where you are actually seeing a bond being
forged in
some sort of
formation.
I felt that any sort of, yes, it was being unfolded, it was being discovered, it was being accepted, all of that. Otherwise, the use of the music has been to dramatize or to motivate or to sometimes even give some spiritual soothing touches. That's how I feel that the, that's how I read the movements of the music.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And another interesting theme, which I personally felt worked at a very sort of metaphorical level in the film, is how sports was used, you know. I mean, again, because we didn't get the chance to interact with the director or anyone from the film, we can only guess whether this was done consciously or unconsciously. But then I felt that the motif of sports was used to very effectively expose the disparities in the societies that we live in, especially in India, where by the virtue of sometimes just one's geographical location, one is rendered at a disadvantaged position. You know, we see how Sana Jawba gets defeated by a player from Kerala at the national level championship. And when people keep asking him, or, you know, when they discuss as to why he lost despite training so hard, the reasons given by the characters actually tells you that, you know, it tells you how the systems actually work in reality. You know, there is a lack of resources, there is a lack of funding, there is a lack of visibility, etc., in this region in general. And we see this and we see this theme constantly repeating in the various films that have emerged from this part of the country. And all of this generally keeps and has largely kept communities and tribes from this part of the country, that is from India's northeast, from attaining the center stage nationally, which they definitely deserve. And you know, finally, what I would really like to emphasize on, which I also feel is in continuation of what this whole sports motif brings about in the film, about, you know, this region constantly being in the shadows, is the kind of struggle that you and I went through to actually watch a good version, a good print of this film. It was just not available. And, you know, I would really like to draw the attention of our listeners to this particular point, because this is why we started the podcast in the first place. You know, we wanted to talk about why it is still so difficult to access good quality entertainment from the Northeast. And I would really urge our listeners to go and watch this film on YouTube and see for themselves as to just how heartbreakingly poor the quality of the only digital print of the film that is available as of now is, to the point where even, I mean, the highest quality available, the highest I think it's called quality, right? That 480, 144, I'm really bad with all these technical terms, but the highest quality that's available is 480. And even then, you can't read the text, you know, when the credits are rolling and credits are rolling. You can't read the text at all. And it's just so heartbreaking. Besides Cinema from Assam, I'm sure Shibunthi is going to agree with me because we have been in this journey together for like months now. Besides Cinema from Assam, we at Cinemators are continuously struggling to get hold of cinema from any other part of the northeast of India. We are hitting extremely sorry dead ends. In fact, you know, we were super excited to take up this one Khasi film that we managed to hunt down called Onatha. And it was streaming on Netflix, but now, unfortunately, it's been taken down from Netflix as well, so we cannot discuss it. And there is no way we can talk about this film on the podcast until and unless it's made available on Netflix or on one of the other streaming platforms where all our listeners can easily access and watch it. We did consider reaching out to the filmmakers of some of these films that we had wanted to discuss, and we wanted to request them for screeners, but we realized that, you know, this would totally defeat the purpose of the podcast, which is to bring attention to the films readily accessible but lesser known to our audience. So if any of the filmmakers from the Northeast are listening to us, or if Netflix or any of the other platforms are listening to us, please bring more films made in the Northeast to your platforms and plug this really gaping lacuna that exists. You know, we really need to do that. And yeah, I mean, that's really all that I had to say about this really sorted situation. But before we wrap up, we have our final segment, which is films that deal with similar themes that our audiences and our listeners can watch. So Shivanti, please do enlighten us there.
Correct. Also, to add to what you were already saying about availability of films in these languages from the different parts of northeast of India, I also feel that it is quite sad that because YouTube is largely, you know, accessible, but the print that is available is not very user friendly, even though it is accessible. And I was also quite thrilled to find that Phitiki Moni as a film is actually part of a syllabus of Mount Carmel College
Bangalore,
where they have a course called additional English, you know. And in that course, they are trying to bring in discussions around socio-political and cultural events and analysis through literary texts and visuals, through essay, poetry, and other, materials. And Phitiki Moni happens to be a film that they have chosen to incorporate as a part of their second semester course. And I think it's a recent course that I chanced upon, which is running for 2018 to 2021 batch. Now, also, I realized that even film schools or departments teaching film studies, they do screen Phitiki Moni as one of film from other regional languages to be seen and to be discussed, which makes it a very relevant film in itself. And it should be available on, you know, other OTT platforms or, you know, especially Netflix, because primarily it talks about kinship, it talks about, religion, it talks about community, and definitely it talks about patriarchal system and the gendered relationship, which we all, which we have been discussing throughout.
Right.
Now coming back to just how can we think about parallel films? There is a touch of obsession even in this giving attitude of the mother, because the obsession is about the well-being and blind faith in the son, in a way, you know. And I feel there was a film called Itching, which is a 2011 film only by Shivo Prashad Mukherjee and Nandita Roy, based on Suchitra Bhattacharya's novel, Okay, and that is a different tangent altogether, but it actually tells you how the mother interferes in the son's life, because the mother wishes the son to have a particular way of life, and she wants to be part of his life in a very
intimate
way. Prominent way.
Right.
Yeah, intimate and prominent, where she doesn't even entertain other kind of relationship that her son ends up having. So she successfully disrupts her first relationship, but is unable to do so when he eventually moves on. Although here the moving apart between the mother and son is very different, where he actually says goodbye and starts a new life.
Yeah.
In this case, you see that the son, for some reason, has not been able to include his mother about what is going on in his life, because, you know, he has suddenly taken a decision to start his family.
Yes.
But eventually comes around to, explain and accept how the situations have been, and comes close to the mother. So, but this whole mother-son relationship and love taking a turn towards obsession and obedience suddenly becoming, disobedience and eventually fading away of relationship is something that comes forth. The
right.
other series, in fact, it's not a film, but I am really into Korean series these days.
Right.
But this
Aren't
is
we
a
all?
Very nice. This is a very nice Korean TV series by Oh Hyun Jung and Nam Sung Yoo.
Okay.
Weightlifting Fairy Kim Bok Ju, which is
right.
a 2016 to 2018 South Korean TV drama.
Yeah.
Which actually talks about the sports academy, and where it's a coming of age drama about the, the same problems about infrastructure, about economy, about aspirations, about a sporting life. And it's a light romance, yes, but it's more about their career path. It is about this short story between the weightlifter, who is the protagonist, and Lee Sung-kyung, that is, and the other protagonist, who is a swimmer. So it's interesting because it draws the struggles and the challenges of being in the sporting academy and taking life ahead. And this also shows the struggle of a middle-class family, because the protagonist's father just runs a restaurant where he primarily is famous for selling fried chicken, you see the struggle, and you see the dreams, and you see the difficulty, and also what happens when you fail, because there are stories that are also incorporated of failed athletes in that. And here, this film is actually talking about failed athletes in a way, and how they could not make it to the mainstream, yes, because of lack of visibility, because of access, because of maybe insurgency, which is so rampant in the area.
Yes.
Which is subtly, of the setup. And it is relevant because it talks about why certain career choices do not pan out well.
Right.
How communities respond to crisis situations, and definitely the family dynamics, which become prominent, like all other films that we've been talking about,
which usually end up assuming center stage. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Superb. That was lovely. And with that, we finally come to the very end of yet another episode of Cinematters. Do not forget to tune in and subscribe to more episodes on First Post's YouTube channel, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and wherever else you get your podcasts. We promise to bring you more such fascinating films from the Northeast of India, and we will tell you why you should be watching them and discussing them if you're not doing so already. So until next time, this is your host Arshia Dhaur signing off with Shibunti Chatterjee from Cinemators by First Post.